ऑफ एनाटॉमी GMCH मीरज.
नाउ लेट्स वेलकम आवर कंटेस्टेंट्स टीम एम्बर फ्रॉम LTMMC सायन.
टीम ओकर फ्रॉम GMC मीरज थर्ड मेजर टीम.
एंड टीम ओपल फ्रॉम GMC मीरज इंटर्न. So the quiz will be conducted in 3 rounds. Round 1 will be a question answer round.
Round 2 will be case diagnosis, where you'll have to diagnose the clinical case given to you.
And round 3, our finale round, the buzzer round.
Each team will be asked 3 questions. For every correct answer that you give, you'll score 10 marks. No marks will be deducted for wrong answer, but you'll have to answer within 20 seconds. Questions in this round are not passable.
Beginning with our round 1A, the stereotype. Answer, the most common. So team Amber, are you guys ready? So team Amber, are you guys ready? Question 1, please. What is the most common malignancy seen in children?
Your time starts now.
ALL.
That's correct. 10 points to team Amber. Question 2, please. Which is the most common hernia to strangulate? That's correct.
That's the right answer.
10 points to team Ocker.
Next question to team Opal. Which is the most common extranodal site of lymphoma?
Mediastinum.
Sorry, that's the wrong answer. The right answer is stomach.
Coming to our next sub round, 1B, constellation. Here, you'll be given a series of clinical manifestations and you'll have to diagnose the disease. So let's proceed.
So question 1 to team Amber. Gastrointestinal polyps, along with multiple osteomas and skin and soft tissue tumors. What's your diagnosis?
Peutz-Jeghers syndrome.
Sorry, that's incorrect. The right answer is Gardner syndrome.
So Gardner syndrome, it is an autosomal dominant condition which is characterized by mutation in APC gene.
Next question to team Ocker. Uveitis with genital ulcers and recurrent oral aphthous ulcers. What is your diagnosis? Yes, that's correct. Basis disease, also known as silk road disease, causes vasculitis throughout the body, leading to the above manifestations.
So next question to team Opal. Chorioretinitis along with hydrocephalus and intracranial calcifications.
Congenital toxoplasmosis.
Yes, that's right. So in congenital toxoplasmosis, CT or MRI shows multiple calcifications predominantly found in basal ganglia, corticomedullary junctions, and to a lesser extent in the periventricular regions.
Beginning with the next round, 1C, the radiological features. Name the condition in which the given radiological sign is seen.
So shall we begin, team Amber? Question 1. Pelkin's spur on radiology is seen in which condition?
Scurvy.
Yes, that's the right answer, scurvy.
Next question to team Ocker. Water lily sign on chest radiograph is characteristically seen in which condition? That's correct.
Next question to team Opal. Box-shaped heart on chest radiograph is characteristically seen in which condition? Sir, time is running out.
Epstein's anomaly?
Yes, that's the right answer. Epstein anomaly. Okay, so you won't get points for this. Moving on to round 1D, scrutinize, where you will have to diagnose a disease based on the gross and microscopic features.
First question for Team Amber. Christmas tree appearance is seen in which type of cataract?
Myotonic dystrophy.
That's correct.
We request you guys to support your favorite team. Second question to Team Ocker. Chicken wire appearance, that is calcifications, on histopath is seen in which tumor? In which tumor?
Can you be louder? No, that's incorrect. The right answer is chondroblastoma. Third question for Team Opal. Maltese cross appearance on blood film is pathognomonic feature of?
Babesia?
Yes, that's correct.
So at the end of round one, the scores are? Team Amber with 40 points. So sorry. Team Amber with 30 points. Team Ocker with 30 points. And Team Opal with 20 points.
Before we proceed to our next round, let's see if our audience can answer this question.
Microcytic anemia, along with... That's the right answer. So we have got a smart audience today with us.
Quality over quantity.
Patterns in calcium.
Now let's begin with round two, the case diagnosis.
Each team will be given a clinical case comprised of general information, history, findings of general, local, and systemic examination.
Case approach of the participants will be assessed by the judges.
The participants will then have to give their differential diagnosis to the judges.
Investigations related to the case will be displayed on the screen. Each team can select 5 investigations of their choice out of 12, the results of which will then be displayed on the screen.
The participants will then have to give their final diagnosis to the judges.
This will be followed by a question answer round.
Marks will be given depending upon the case approach, differentials, choice of investigations, number of investigations selected, final diagnosis, and question answer round. I would request Team Amber to come forward and read out their case. Yes.
A 4-year-old male child is brought to the emergency department by his mother with the chief complaints of vomiting and bloody diarrhea since 4 days. He has had no fever, ill contacts, or recent exposure to children with diarrhea. His urine output has been markedly reduced since last night. His mother gave a history that the child has attended a birthday party recently. No other symptoms were present and he has no comorbidities. His birth history is unremarkable and all immunizations are up to date. On general examination, the child was irritable and mildly febrile, pale. There was no icterus, lymphadenopathy, or cyanosis. No edema, purpura, or active bleeding was noted. Vitals, pulse 120 beats per minute, regular, satisfactory volume. Blood pressure 90/70 mm of Hg. Respiratory rate 24 cycles per minute, abdominothoracic. JVP not elevated. Tympanic membrane is normal. Conjunctiva are pale. There is no nasal flaring or palatal petechiae. His oral mucosa is moist and his tongue is pale. His genitalia and anus are normal. No rectal prolapse. Systemic examination, CVS, S1, S2 normal, no murmur. Respiratory system clear with good aeration. Per abdominal examination, abdomen is flat. There was generalized tenderness with mild hepatosplenomegaly. CNS higher functions are normal, no neurological abnormalities noted.
I request the judges to take over with case differentials.
Okay, so team Amber, first question from case approach point. Which system do you think is involved?
So according to me, the GIT has been involved along with the renal system.
According to you only or all other three? Okay, fine. Okay, so you feel GIT and renal?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so two system you want to think. Okay. The second question, sir, what pathological process do you think is involved?
The GIT manifestations are because of damage probably by a microorganism, and the renal manifestations are because of a toxin-mediated damage.
So pathological process do you think is inflammation?
Yes, sir.
Invasion and inflammation?
Yes, sir. Invasion and inflammation.
Okay. So now this is two questions which I'm supposed to ask in clinical approach, case approach. Now the second thing is, with this case approach and the system already you think what you involved, what can be the differential diagnosis? How many you want to put? Only one. If you put only one differential diagnosis, you know, we already explained. So what, how many differential diagnosis you want to put?
So according
first
to
tell
us
the number. Two, so one or three, how many differential diagnosis you want? Okay.
So two differential diagnoses.
Okay.
First differential diagnosis is acute dysentery along with hemolytic uremic syndrome due to enterohemorrhagica E. coli O157H7. Second differential will be acute dysentery with hemolytic uremic syndrome due to Shigella dysentery.
Okay, you have all means. Can I ask the further question? This is not the marks question. But how do you enter into this such an in-depth microbiology only with the history and examination that you have been doing the strains of the bacteria also?
Because the most common enterohemorrhagic E. coli causing the bloody diarrhea is O157H7, and these two, the Shigella and enterohemorrhagic E. coli, these two can cause the hemolytic uremic syndrome due to the virotoxin that they release.
That is absolutely correct. Once you consider the diagnosis as HUS, but suppose it is not an HUS now.
Sir, then we can broaden our differentials.
No, you already told that you are only
sir,
HUS.
If there is no HUS, then it can be bloody diarrhea because of a bacteria or a parasite.
Okay, so these are not the marks question, but yes. I feel differential diagnosis should be very small,
yes,
and it is not being so in depth microbiologically before further investigation should be done. Okay, so now next part of the questions is asking you me about choice of investigations and number of investigations. So you want to choose some investigations to do and confirm your diagnosis?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so how many? You can tell me the number first. How many you want to choose? Because depending on the numbers, you will get the marks.
You get 30 seconds.
Yeah.
You can give mark.
Six investigations.
You can choose only maximum five.
So five investigations, sorry, sir.
Okay. So now which five you tell, and they will, I think, open one by one, isn't it?
First will be stool sample.
Okay. So see. Okay, done. Okay, next.
Bleeding time, clotting time, coagulation profile.
Okay, third. Wait. third investigation?
Yes, sir. CBC and peripheral blood smear.
Okay. First one.
Next investigation.
You want which one?
Sir,
show again the list. Show again the list.
Please display the list.
Yeah.
Seven. Investigation number seven.
Okay.
The full form of ADAM TS13 is a disintegrin and metalloproteinase with thrombosponding type 1 motif member 13.
Last investigation will be urine analysis and renal function tests.
Please scroll up.
Yeah, that is final. So you're done with your five investigations and assessment of five investigations. What do you choose from that 12, the list of 12 given to you?
Yes,
okay.
Sir.
Okay, so as you know, this round also consists of the marks, depending on which for you, we logically think are more important and you could have been chosen, okay? But whatever you have chosen, accordingly we are given the marks. So now you also know what are the investigations there, okay? So now shall we go for the next part of it is, what is your final diagnosis?
Sir, my final diagnosis will be acute dysentery with hemolytic uremic syndrome due to Shigella.
Shigella, okay. So we are over with five points. Now last one, question answer session. Your diagnosis is correct, okay? So you will get that mark. But though we are far from mathematics, we have kept this case not all marks for only diagnosis. It's only 5 marks out of 40. Everything else is depending on the case approach. The investigation is used different. That is explained to you well. Okay. So now the last is also there are marks on question answer session. So you have to answer very short. The questions also will be almost like leading. Can you tell me the triad of diagnosis of HUS, hemolytic uremic syndrome?
Thrombocytopenia, hemolytic anemia, and renal failure, AKI.
Absolutely correct. Second question. Which are the two major pathophysiological related types of HUS?
Typical HUS and atypical HUS.
So what do you mean by that?
Typical HUS probably has a history of dysentery or diarrhea. Atypical is normally not associated with his history of diarrhea or dysentery. More common in adults is atypical, and more common in children is typical. Means all of above, HUS is more common in children. While recurrence rate of typical HUS is very low, recurrence rate of atypical HUS is...
Typical HUS, the most important thing is the etiological factor which differentiates. Ah. Otherwise, clinically both are almost same. So recurrence and all other things, but the presentation is almost same. So what is exactly that is called as typical HUS, depending on the etiology, the word classification? Do we call it as a typical as a clinical presentation? Pathophysiological word of that is?
toxin-mediated HUS.
Yeah, that is called a steck HUS. Steck HUS. Yes. And other is a atypical HUS. Yes. Atypical HUS, you did not told me, is a pathophysiology. Or not pathophysiology, but which organism or which infection precedes.
So no idea. We haven't.
Okay. So that is what second question was. Okay. Okay. So I think I have done with this, and you have done very well. You are diagnosed very well, and almost everything was okay. The marks will be given to the according to how you have performed. Okay. Thank you.
I request Team Ocker to read out the case handed over to them.
A 65-year-old female presented to the emergency department with pain over the left side of her face for 7 days, with subsequent development of swelling on the left side of face and periorbital edema. She is a known case of diabetes mellitus type 2 since past 8 years, with poorly controlled blood sugars. She belonged to the low socioeconomic status, and there was no history of any similar complaints in the past or any in the family members. There was no history of trauma to the face, dental procedure, fever, chest pain, earache. At the time of admission, the patient was stuporous, BP 140 by 90 mm of Hg, pulse rate 80 bpm, respiratory rate 18 per minute, temperature 98 Fahrenheit, random BSL 425 mg per dl. On examination, she was conscious but not following commands. Although she was able to move all four limbs, there was facial edema more on the left side with bilateral periorbital edema, ptosis with purulent discharge, and inability to open her left eye. There was no proptosis of either eye. The right eye was normal. There was slight bluish discoloration of skin over the left half of her face near the nose and eye. There was nasal congestion and discharge noted. Oropharyngeal examination was unremarkable, and the neck was supple without any lymphadenopathy. CVS, RS, and abdominal findings were all normal.
Now, with this clinical scenario, which systems are involved? One system, two system, three systems, which systems are involved?
Upper respiratory system and CNS.
Are you correct? Yeah, think again. How many systems are involved here?
Sinuses, orbit. And
that is your RTI, upper respiratory ho gaya. Sinuses. Next.
Orbit.
Orbit, okay.
And CNS.
CNS, anything? Another system?
Endocrine.
Very good, very good. So there are multiple system involvement is there. Okay. So diabetes mellitus, that is endocrinology, CNS involvement and respected involvement plus I, CNS involvement. Okay. Now, with these findings and the systems involved, four immune systems with the symptomatology and findings, what conclusion you have got with your clinical findings and history wise? That is depression. So, in order of priority, before going towards investigation, what is your priority diagnosis? 1, 2, 3. See, diagnosis indicates clinical diagnosis, pathological, anatomical. Okay? All the three components should be there in your diagnosis.
There is a sinus, orbital, and cerebral involvement anatomically. There is no fever, and I would. Sir, can I explain it in this manner?
Yes, we are very good.
Since there is no fever.
I will ask why there is no fever. Then one more question will be coming there. Okay. Very good. Okay. I'm happy. Good. Come on.
Since there is no fever and the lesion is, the inflammation is localized, I would go towards the diagnosis of probably a fungal infection because of no fever and localization.
Why fungal, madam?
And
why not conjunctivitis or uveitis or this...
Sir, typically there is a history of uncontrolled diabetes mellitus.
Yes, this is uncontrolled diabetes. So why uncontrolled diabetes leads only to fungal infection? Why not other infections?
Because there is it is an immunocompromised state.
Okay.
Therefore.
Then why only fungus? There are so many conditions which can be associated with immunocompromised status.
According to the history, she also belongs to low socioeconomic status,
yes.
Poorly controlled diabetes. Along with that, the negative history sort of rules
out. What impact of poor socioeconomic group in this patient? See, every point that they are given, this should be justified.
Low socioeconomic status means the chances of infections like fungal infections, which are not seen in the normal.
So diabetes can occur with poor people and high social people also. The chances can be the same.
Treatment of diabetes is not there.
That's why she's socioeconomic condition. She may not be offering the treatment, proper treatment. She may be taking intermittent treatment because of social financial constraint. She may not be taken. Okay. Any other kind of this is fungal infection. Next, how will you complete diagnosis? See, I told you anatomical, pathological, clinical component should be there completely. Anatomically, you told me eyes involved, sinus involved. Then diabetes is there, and fungal infection. How will you compose your diagnosis?
Left-sided sino orbito cerebro mucor mycosis.
Cerebro? Where it has come, cerebro, madam?
Maybe it is spread through the
diabetes ketoacidosis. She may be in hypoglycemia also.
Sir, there are no other signs suggestive of ketoacidosis, as in the breathing and...
What sign do you want?
The breathing is normal. I thought if it is an acidotic breathing, might be present in DK.
How will come in picture the acidotic breathing and
the respiratory
picture?
Rate has been mentioned normal.
How the ketotic breathing will come on writing? Tell me.
Yes, sir. The stuporous can be because of DK, can be because of
hypoglycemia. Or she's pointing to cerebral involvement also. Okay.
Since the spread will be in that direction, sino or beta cerebral.
No, complete diagonal now. Still you have your chances.
Mucor mycosis with uncontrolled diabetes.
Okay. But mucor mycosis would lead to sinuses. And uncontrolled diabetes, that's why she may be hypoglycemic or hyperglycemic. She is hyperglycemia, not in hypoglycemia.
Yes, her blood.
They have given 425, which indicates strongly she must be in diabetic ketosis. This 425 is enough to go, stay that it may be diabetic ketosis. And clinically, you may find when you examine the patient, you may find what? There, you go to nearer to the patient. In a patient diabetes, you will be getting aromatic breath smell.
They
are not written.
That is why we did not go towards DK, because the specific findings of DK were not
mentioned. With altered sensorium, with mucor mycosis, that goes in favor of this severe hyperglycemia and co-diabetes. Maybe,
okay.
How will you, now you have come to conclusions, tell me, this is mucor mycosis.
Left-sided sino-orbito-cerebro-mucor mycosis with uncontrolled diabetes mellitus. And the patient is in stuporous.
Stuporous, okay. So this is diagnosis. Okay. Any other diagnosis with this, madam?
No, sir. We would like to go with single diagnosis. We would like to go with only one diagnosis.
Only one? No other? Any other differential diagnosis? What do you feel? Because they are given a nasal discharge and everything, you are suspecting only mucor mycosis? She is stuporous with eye signs. She may be in a hypothyroid state also. Still, you want to want only one diagnosis?
Yes, sir.
Sure?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now tell me, what investigation would you like to go for to confirm your diagnosis? And that out of 12, you'll have to go for only 5.
Maximum 5, you can go for minimum.
If you go for minimum, you'll be given more marks. Am I right, sir?
Yes.
Your time is running out.
Which university want to have this first?
Five number.
Five. Which one?
First CT.
CT is sixth number.
Yes, sir.
CT six just?
There are two CTs.
Eight numbers,
sir. CT paranasal sinuses.
CT parasinuses. Okay. Now see the see the picture of the work here. And sir will guide you here now.
Can anyone of you explain it?
You should explain. Read the CT.
CT paranasal sinuses shows opacification in left maxillary sinus and facial edema on left side.
Okay. Have them been given marker? Pointer.
Marker.
Okay. Back image. Okay. Are you seeing orbit in this image?
No. Sorry. Maxillary sinus.
And one more. Any other sinus you are getting? In this axial image.
Ithmoid sinus.
Yes, very good. Yes.
Where is it? Just point out
ithmoid. Point out ithmoid. Okay. Any more? This? It is also involved, huh? You are getting same density lesion here, okay? Huh? We can see. There is no soft tissue swelling here. It is seen here. Okay.
Can it be a plain simple sinusitis, full maxillary ethmoid sinuses? Next condition.
Nasal smear.
Okay. Can you put the result of nasal smear?
Scroll down, please. Lactophenol cotton blue preparation of the specimen showed filamentous fungus with aseptate hyphae branching at right angles, rhizoids, sporangia, and sporangiophores.
Other investigation? You have to make hurry.
Arterial blood gas analysis.
Okay. Put the results of blood gas analysis.
Blood gas.
Nine. Arterial blood gas analysis, ABG analysis revealed metabolic acidosis, low bicarbonate levels, and low pH.
Okay. How many investigations you have suggested?
Five.
Three are over.
Yes, three. Do you want more?
Or you want more than this list?
They already said. Which one?
MRI brain.
Okay.
Take MRI.
T2 weighted axial MRI shows hyper intense left ethmoid cells. Soft tissue swelling is seen anterior to the left eyeball. Left orbital hyper intense signal intensity lesion is seen, extending along orbital apex into left cavernous sinus, lateral to left internal carotid artery.
Comment more about this?
There may be cavernous sinus involvement, so
okay.
Might be the reason of the periorbital edema.
Okay.
And stuporous
state, yes.
Okay.
Of patient.
Okay. But for orbital sinus, for sinuses and orbit CT is enough. Why they would done MRI brain?
Can be because of third nerve involvement in cavernous sinus.
Okay, okay. More than that, any other reason?
It may spread up in cerebrum. So
very good, very good. What you said, spread to the left cavernous sinus, related complications, it's okay. More than that, typically what diagnosis you have put for what?
To cerebrum. Sino-orbito cerebrum.
Okay, okay, okay. Then in fungal infections, there will be more involvement of the meninges, which we can't see on the CTs. For contrast MRI, brain is the investigation of choice to diagnose meningitis. Meningeal masses. Okay, that's why MRI brain has been done in this case.
Now
one investigation is remaining.
Want now or you don't want?
No. How will you confirm cerebral involvement now? Tell me. MRI will tell you that it is confirmed.
CSF findings.
Very good.
CSF findings, please. CSF findings, cells, modest neutrophilic pleocytosis, CSF proteins and glucose within normal range, CSF pressure 150 mm of water.
It is not bacterial or viral. Upper limit of the normal. Up to 160, it can, 80 to 160 we can take normal. So it is up 160. Water.
Huh. Okay, see, upper limit, that means slightly raised.
Slightly raised.
Okay, and clinically also you are getting that stuporous stage. Okay. So there is some meningeal irritation is there. Though there not be proteins, but there are cells are increased because of extension of inpatient towards the cerebral lesion. That is cavernous sinus thrombosis. Okay. Now, what is your final diagnosis now?
Left-sided sino-orbito cerebral mucor mycosis with uncontrolled diabetes and diabetic ketoacidosis.
Okay. Do you want to add anything more? So it is sino. What is your diagnosis? Complete diagnosis?
Sino-orbito,
cerebral mucor mycosis
with uncontrolled diabetes and diabetic
ketoacidosis. So, you are absolutely correct. Now, what we do now further? Okay. Is it an emergency or you can manage OPD basis? Why emergency, madam? Why it is emergency?
Involvement of cerebrum. So,
DK makes it a emergency in this case because the patient is stuporous and also there is involvement.
That is
the
basic disease she is having. Now in addition to that, she is having one dreaded disease, that is mucormycosis. Are you giving weightage to the mucormycosis or not? Yes. Or you want to control only diabetes?
No, sir. First mucormycosis.
Why?
If we do not control it, then it will spread to cerebrum and other
sinus. It has already spread, madam. It has gone to the cerebrum. What is the prognosis of this patient
progress to coma and
coma ho gaya hai, abhi ho gaya coma. Already is coma.
Sir, yeah, it is not now only in stupor. It will
neurological damage can happen.
How? Why?
Because of the spread of. because of the spread of mucor mycosis to the cerebrum and complete involvement of
it is a rapidly
progressive
necrotizing severely fatal disease. You should be treated aggressively with basic control of glycemic buffer control. What is the treatment? How you have controlled diabetes? Now, what is the proper treatment for mucormycosis? How do you treat mucormycosis?
First, antifungal treatment.
Yes.
Intravenous.
Yeah. What is antifungal treatment?
We can give amphotericin B.
What is the dose?
Dose we don't know.
Okay.
Or voriconazole we can use.
Oh, yeah, that's oral. But how many days should be given?
At least 6 weeks.
I'm telling you, this is acute emergency.
Yes.
It cannot be managed only by physician or endocrinologist here now. What other treatment option will you give? Anybody surgeon here? This is necrotic disease, surround tissue involved, so surgical excision is important in this patient after controlling good glycemic control. Otherwise, fatality is very high. Okay. Good.
I would request the audience not to answers. I request team Opal to read out the case.
A 55-year-old man presented with intermittent abdominal pain for 4 months, dyspepsia and weight loss, episodic hot flushes involving the face and upper chest for 2 months, lasting for 2 to 5 minutes, and watery stools 5 to 6 episodes per day for 1 month. He had dry cough for 8 days. He had no comorbid illness and the family history was not significant. On examination, patient was conscious and alert, vitals, pulse is 90 beats per minute, blood pressure is 130/90 mmHg, respiratory rate is 18 per minute, temperature is 37.5 degrees Celsius. Patient was ectric with mild pedal edema, no lymphadenopathy or cyanosis noted. Red flushes was noted over face and trunk lasting for few minutes without leaving a permanent scar. Heart, lung and CNS findings were unremarkable. Per abdominal examination revealed abdominal sensitivity at palpation, hepatomegaly of firm consistency, irregular surface, and hard palpable mass in the epigastrium.
Ready with the conclusion?
Yes, sir.
As per the history, clinical findings, which system is involved?
Sir, gastrointestinal system is involved.
You have read the symptoms, no? So.
Yes, sir.
Any other system is involved?
Gastrointestinal with hepatobiliary involvement.
Hepatobiliary. Because finding is there is icterus.
Yes, sir, icterus and hepatomegaly.
Any other system involved?
Sir, because of dry cough, we can also say lung. And he's having flushes, so cardiovascular system also we can take into consideration.
Only in cardiovascular disease you can have flushes?
No, not the entire, just because vasodilation, considering vasodilation as a phenomenon in our mind.
Okay, so GIT, lung and?
Hepatobiliary system.
Hepatobiliary and cardiovascular, these are four systems involved. Okay. What pathology or process is going on there? What do you feel there?
Sir, looking at three classical symptoms, episodic flushes, watery stools, and dry cough, it mostly points towards carcinoid syndrome, and which in carcinoid syndrome, which occurs because of over secretion of serotonin, bradykinin. So there may be dry cough because of bradykinin. Watery stools also explains serotonin's prokinetic activity, and hot flushes also explains the vasodilatory action of the serotonin.
Okay. So, what do you diagnose now with this pathologic process? Differential diagnosis?
How many differential
Sir, I would like to give two differential diagnoses. First is carcinoid syndrome with liver metastasis secondary to a neuroendocrinal tumor. Which may be gastrointestinal stromal tumor. Second is hepatocellular carcinoma with paraneoplastic syndrome.
two different diagnoses.
Yes.
One is, first is?
Carcinoid syndrome with liver metastasis, secondary to neuroendocrinal tumor.
Where is the tumor? See, in diagnosis, we anatomy.
Gastrointestinal stromal tumor.
Where? Jatrum, right from teeth to the anal opening. Where does it stay? Anatomical.
Sir, gastric.
Exact situation I want. You're good clinical finding, you know?
Yes, sir.
Where is the?
Sir, pylorus, maybe.
Maybe pylorus.
Yes.
But it is in the epigastric, no?
Yes, sir.
The pylorus could be right on the right side slightly. Or pylorus, this can be also hepatic, liver general, no?
Yes, there, sir, body of the stomach. Gastrointestinal stromal tumor present in the body of the stomach.
Now you should know what are the common sites for carcinoid syndrome to be situated in the abdomen. So you are thinking in terms of pylorus. Situation of the tumor, carcinoid tumor, it is in the pyloric end of the stomach.
I would consider body.
Body of the?
Stomach.
Where? To control diagnosis, how to do further? What investigation would you like to go?
How many?
These are the battery of investigations. You are ahead of us, huh? Who is operating? Yes, out of this?
Sir, five investigations.
Five investigations, okay. Okay.
Sir, first investigation that I would like to choose is serum chromogranin A levels.
Where is it? Okay.
Third.
Show it to the results.
Results for serum chromogranin A levels, please.
Madam, you are helping them? Who is operating?
Sir, I'm not operating.
Who is operating?
Sir, the plasma chromogranin levels here are 1300 nanograms per ml, so they are elevated. So it is a marker for a neuroendocrine tumor, serum chromogranin A.
Next investigation.
CT scan abdomen, 9th one.
Read it out.
CT abdomen revealed a mass encasing the terminal ileum at risk in a multiple nodules in the liver, suggesting liver metastasis.
Okay. Asterisk is present in figure A.
See, this is in the right iliac fossa, okay?
Yes.
We are getting IC junction here, okay?
Yes.
This is a, if you trace whole of the bowels, there is some abnormality here. It is enhancing also. This is non-enhancing bowel, okay?
Yes.
So you are saying it's a tumor, primary situated, it's okay, okay. Another image showing CT scan abdomen, having a showing section of the liver, we are getting a heterogeneous lesion. Okay, most likely as per the history, it should has to be a METS.
Metastasis.
Okay. Okay.
Liver profile.
Okay, abnormal.
Yes, sir.
Yes, this abnormal. Is because of
Sir, liver involvement.
In what secondaries or if the active part is going on there or reaction is going on there?
Sorry, sir?
It is because of meds? It is metastasis or some active hepatitis going on?
Sir, secondary involvement as shown in the radiographic finding also suggested that it is a metastatic lesion. So it corroborates with the liver profile.
Okay, next lesion. Next, what do you want?
Sir, endoscopy guided biopsy, 10th number.
10th. Yes, so it confirms your diagnosis.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Next, any other?
Sir, it almost confirmed.
Your confirmed diagnosis, but at the same time there is mass. You should give some guidance to the surgeon.
Yes, sir.
What next need we should like to go for? Because you want to give cure to the patient.
Yes, sir.
Either medical treatment or surgical treatment. Before surgery, would you like to go for one more invasion or not? Now, CT, abdomen, endoscopy, everything, all right. So you should give some assist to the invasion to help us for further treatment, management of the patient.
Sir, endoscopy.
Endoscopy. Endoscopy. Yes.
Capsule endoscopy revealed a stenosing vegetative tumor in the region of terminal ileum.
Everybody is able to see the tumor?
Yes, sir.
Final diagnosis.
Come on. Final diagnosis is carcinoid syndrome with liver metastasis secondary to a neuroendocrinal tumor, which is present as suggested by radiological and findings. It is present in terminal ileum.
So, is it a surgical case or medical case now?
Sir, it is a surgical case.
So you want to remove that panel because it causing obstruction.
Yes, sir.
So it is a complete diagnosis now. Once again, tell me complete diagnosis.
Sir, complete diagnosis will be carcinoid syndrome with liver metastasis secondary to neuroendocrinal tumor situated in terminal ileum and stenosing the lumen.
Yes. Okay. Good. How will you for? What are the presentations of this carcinoid syndrome?
Sir,
see, visual diagnosis, does it occur immediately within a month or it takes time to diagnose this case?
There is a triad for carcinoid syndrome, which it is intermittent hot flushes, wheezing, and watery stools. So all these three were present in the history. That is why the first thing that came into our mind was carcinoid syndrome.
Why? Because of which? Secretion, the symptoms are
there. Sir, serotonin secretion. Serotonin and bradykinin. Huh. Bradykinin explains the cough, the dry cough as shown in the history.
Okay. How will you manage the case now? What are the drugs to be used for this, for symptomatic relief?
Sir, first we can, for symptomatic treatment, firstly to decrease the flushes, we can give a somatostatin analog octreotide. And after symptoms decrease a little bit, then we can go for a surgical approach.
Before the doctor is a costly one. We are working in the government hospital. Some cheaper drugs. Other than before going for surgery, any other H1H2 blocker or kuch hai kya? Any other presentation can present present in patient because of this increased secretion of these amines, hot flushes and everything.
Sir, hypertension can be a presentation.
Good. Okay. Sir, anything else?
So at the end of round two, the scores so far are Team Amber with 50 points, Team Ocker with 51 points, and Team Opal with 40 points.
Before moving on to the next round, let's ask this question to our audience. Look at the image given below and identify the condition. Name the characteristic radiographic sign seen in the image. Yeah, that's correct. It's never over until it's completely over.
Coming to our finale round, the buzzer round. So the rules for this round are: a short case history along with an image will be displayed on the screen.
Team which presses the buzzer first will be allowed to answer the question.
For each correct answer, you will score 20 marks. For every wrong answer, or if you don't answer after pressing the buzzer, 10 marks will be deducted. If first team answers the question incorrectly, the questions will be passed on to the next team that has pressed the buzzer.
Please check the buzzers. Wait a sec. No, you can answer in between. Once you press the buzzer, the question will disappear. If you give the correct answer, you get 20 points. If you give the wrong answer, minus 10.
Meantime, we were just discussing after your case second round, and one point which I thought is like you chosen 5 investigations to do it. That's why it was made like that. You have to first tell the numbers how many investigation you want. But do you realize that once you pick up the correct investigation, probably you don't require 5. That is what is the learning from this, number one. Number two is, I don't know, I should not say unfortunately, but I have to ask, is no one was picking the basic investigation CBC. It's like first like a CT, then MRI. I know sir is sitting here, but still, because for example, like I know that, because what is the triad of HUS? So where was the CBC?
Ordered CBC.
Yeah, first ordered CBC. Is the first you have to order CBC. See, marks are not cut because you already ordered CBC, but then it should come in that manner, like what you want to first approach towards the case, isn't it? And probably not the very high fi investigation immediately. Okay, so are we ready with buzzers?
Necessary to find out the how much severity with the comorbid conditions. Okay, that's why. Otherwise, urine were showing 4+ ketone bodies. Not necessary to go for this blood gas analysis. So clinical and bedside investigation, they are very much important.
Yes. Check the buzzers, please. He's there to handle.
See, if it's not working, we can do with hands up. Immediately, we are three sitting here. We can see who has put the hands up. Go for an older method.
Yes.
It's fine with you. You people, okay, it's okay. All important, yeah. For you people. If you, yes. Just you can put up the hands. Okay?
All the best.
Is it so okay with all the three teams?
Yes, yes.
You agree?
Yes.
Okay. And you believe in us?
So, Team Amber, are you guys ready?
It's a buzzer.
So first question, please.
They are not able to see.
A newborn baby presented to NICU with dyspnea at birth.
Wait. We are not able to see from here. I'm not able to read from here.
Okay.
And we can't see through them.
You get the prompters.
We are not.
Diaphragmatic hernia.
अरे यार टेबल ऐसा कर लो ना थोड़ा इस तरफ बैठ जाओ एक टेबल के इस तरफ आ जाओ हेलो एम्बर हेलो So, are you sure it is working now? You see that number? That's over. Okay. Are you?
Yes.
Okay, now what we do, the first question we're disqualified.
Okay.
So we'll do with the nine questions. Sai Kiran, is it correct? Sai Kiran. So we'll do with nine questions? Okay. So start with the second question now.
Second question, please. A 51-year-old man presented with single episode of generalized tonic-clonic seizures. He was a farmer and worked with pigs in past.
Team A.
Neurocystic sarcosis.
That is the right answer. Question three, please. Next question, please. A 15-year-old child presented to ENT OPD with severe pain in the left ear with fever. Team C.
Acute suppurative otitis media.
Yes, that's the right answer.
20 points to Team Opal. 20 points to Team Opal. Next question, please. 11-year-old girl presented to a physician with painful skin lesions on her legs. She had a 3-week history of upper respiratory tract infection for which she was started on amoxicillin. 3 days after starting treatment, she presented with skin lesions on legs as shown below. Drug allergy was ruled out. What is the most likely diagnosis? The right answer is erythema nodosum following streptococcal pharyngitis.
Next question, please. A 37-year-old man presented with worsening abdominal pain. On examination, circumoral pallor was noted. He was diagnosed Team C. What's your answer?
Chronic lead poisoning.
Yes, that's the correct answer. 20 points to Team C.
Next question. An 82-year-old man presented with a 6-week history of headache, decreased vision in both eyes.
Team B. Team B, what's your answer?
Temporal artery arthritis.
That's correct. What is the other name? What is the other name?
Giant cell arthritis.
That's correct. 20 points to Team Ocker.
Next question, please. A 5-year-old female child was brought to the dermatology. Team A.
Molluscum contagiosum.
Right answer. 20 points to Team Amber.
Next question, please. 50-year-old
Borreliosis.
Repeat the question.
Minus 10 points to Team Ocker. Can we display the question, please?
Question? No, we will repeat the question. Now, Team.
Sir, but there was an image. Then you get the image again. Only you two will have
it. Please repeat the question. 50-year-old Caucasian female presented with fever.
Erythema chronicum migrans, Lyme's disease.
That's correct.
Next question.
It's not borreliosis, it's a different thing. Your borrelia burgdorferi cell Lyme's disease. That could be relapsing fever. Borreliosis is different. It's okay, borreliosis is different.
Can we have the next question? A 46-year-old woman presented with sudden onset of bilateral lower extremity pain, numbness, urinary and fecal incontinence, presented for emergency care after becoming non-ambulatory. On clinical examination, ankle jerks were lost, but knee jerks were preserved. Injury to which of the following structures, labeled as A, B, C, is likely to produce the above symptoms?
E.
Team A.
E, E.
Sorry, that's the wrong answer. Minus 10 points to Team Amber.
Please repeat the question.
I'll repeat the question again. A 46-year-old woman presented with sudden onset of bilateral lower extremity pain, numbness, urinary and fecal incontinence presented for emergency care after becoming non-ambulatory. On clinical examination, ankle jerks were lost, but knee jerks were preserved. Injury to which of the following structures, labeled as A, B, C, is likely to produce the above symptoms?
C.
Team Opal, what's
C.
your answer?
C.
That's the wrong answer. Minus 10 points to Team Opal.
Team Ocker, do you want to give it a try? Please repeat the question.
Okay, so the right answer was B, that is the conus medullaris.
This is a case of conus medullaris syndrome. Next question, please. 42-year-old female presented with sudden painful loss of vision. Ocular examination revealed circumcorneal congestion and vertically oval semi-dilated pupil as shown below. Team Amber.
Uveitis.
No, that's incorrect. Minus 10 from Team Amber.
Can we have the question again?
C, second,
Team C. Sorry, Team Opal, what's your answer?
What's your answer?
Yes,
yes, that's correct.
The right answer.
Number.
Plus 20 for Team Opal. Next question, please. Let's have an audience question. 8-year-old healthy girl born by forceps delivery presented with lifelong history of unilateral facial flushing precipitated by eating. What is the diagnosis? That's correct.
What is the answer? Sir, Frey syndrome. Yes, sir. So at the end of our quiz, the scores so far are Team Amber scoring 40 points. Team Ocker, yes ma'am. Team Ocker scoring 10 points. And at the end of round C, the scores are Team Opal scoring 50 points. So the final scores combining the total scores are Team Amber scoring 90 points, Team Ocker scoring 61 points, so Team Amber have scored 90 points so far, Team Ocker have scored 61 points so far, and Team Opal have scored 90 points. So we've got a tie over here between Team Amber and Team Opal. Yes, ma'am. Say it was the final score. So So it is a tie between you both guys.
Excuse
that is Opal
me,
and Amber.
Team member, don't worry. It's all done on the paper. और ये सब तीनों मिला के मार्क्स बोले अभी जो भी आए इट्स ओके So now we are going to have a tiebreaker between team Opal and Amber. And we'll be displaying one question, and whoever knows the answer should raise his or her hand. Whoever answers the question
yes.
wins the quiz. Okay, can we have the question? Judges? Who raised the hand
so
first?
So we raised the hand first.
We have another one.
So we'll be having our next question in 3, 2, 1.
Yes.
Team member.
Asundiki, let them answer.
Lymphocyte predominant.
Yes, that's
answer
the right
correct.
Answer.
So the winner of today's
quiz. Team member, it's like you took a risk even before the question arrived. But that is what is a risk, what you took. That is what, as a judge, we consider. Because if it could not have answered well, they could have been won. So you have taken the risk and you have through it. Well done, all the team, and well done.
So the winners for today's quiz are from LTMMC Cyan. We would like to invite all our quiz masters on the dais and request them to give away the awards to our participants. I would request Dr. Syed sir to felicitate Dr. Bhavisha sir with a token of appreciation.
First of all, thank you very much for calling me for such kind of quiz. And I have been in such quiz in my whatever at 15 years of my career, first time as a direct judge. So now that is a great achievement. But believe me, it's not easy to arrange. It's not easy to arrange because Syed sir and all the students, whatever the questions and they have arranged, I think we should actually appreciate the efforts of everyone. And the whole purpose of Medicincia, is to expose everyone to do this. Everyone to, even sitting in front, how it is difficult to do all these things, it's not that easy. So we understand, whole purpose of Medicincia to get an experience out of this. Nobody's expert here, okay? But then I think they have done a tremendous job, especially Sai Kiran and whole his team was doing such a fantastic job of doing these things. Okay, so thank you all for even attending and making it interesting and being patient also in between. Thank you so much.
I would request Dr. Santosh Vagmode sir to felicitate Dr. D.G. Shitole sir with a token of appreciation.
I would like to request Dr. Santosh Vagmode sir to felicitate Dr. Vaibhav Bingardive sir. I would like to request our quiz committee in charge, Sai Kiran Gunda Boina, to felicitate our teacher in charge, Dr. Sadiq Ali Syed, sir. I would like to request our quiz committee head, Jemima Sheikh, to felicitate our moderator, Dr. Santosh Vagmode, sir. I would request Dr. Uday Singh Patil sir to please come up on the stage. Sir, can you speak a few words?
Yeah, this is really a wonderful experience for me after a long time. I was in a dilemma to which team support, as I belongs to Mirrors and then I did a DM from Science. So it was very dicey situation for me. And I'm very proud to say that the judges, Chitore sir, I have worked as an intern under Chitore sir, and these two are my close friends. I'm very happy to to participate in such a wonderful academic feast. Actually, I'm here since last 2-3 days. Last year also you people have called me as a chairperson for NASH session. This year these people, they met me and say what you are going to do for our students. Then I said this is a very good opportunity to have a quiz, and really I enjoyed it. Thanks a lot, and I'm proud to say that I belong to this college because the academic contents that they are so good. And really I'm happy to say that this is a real the students who are at this moment in this college, they are very lucky so that they are getting exposed to so much of modalities, and the academics really is amazing. Thank you.
I would now request Dr. Uday Singh Patil sir to hand over the cash prize to the winners of today's quiz.
Akanksha Nag. Akash Shukla. Dev Narayan. Request Dr. Bhavesh Shah sir to give away the certificates to our first runner-up. Aman Chaudhary. Omkar Joshi. Aditya Chitnavis. At the end, we would like to thank our judge, our judges, our committee members, our participants. Before ending the quiz, we are proud to announce the success of the first ever Pan India Online Quiz Competition, NKFLOS. We received a tremendous response of about 800 participants from all over the nation. We would love to see the trend continuing further. Thank you and have a good day.